1659, Frenchmen, Sieur de Grésilliers and Pierre Radisson, get far into the interior of North America to live and trade with the Sioux, Illinois, and Cree Indians. They returned from these travels with furs worth a fortune and the belief that the only real way to organize the fur trade was to ship furs direct to Europe from the south of Hudson Bay during the summer months, thus avoiding the tortuous inland water route to the St. Lawrence. In Quebec, their ideas were treated with scorn and derision, and back in France, nobody would listen to their suggestions. However, the two Frenchmen were persuaded to come to England, where their ideas were given a sympathetic hearing. In 1667, Prince Rupert, soldier, courtier, admiral of the fleet, artist, scientist, and cousin of King Charles II, took an interest in their proposals. With a group of English businessmen and courtiers, Prince Rupert purchased and fitted out a small 17th century ketch, the Nonsuch. King Charles loaned the Eaglet, a small vessel belonging to the Royal Navy, and the expedition became a reality. There are no contemporary pictures of the Nonsuch. Drawings of vessels of her size show her to be of 50 tons, 50 foot overall length of hull, and 15 foot wide. Her crew consisted of about 12 men, and in peacetime she carried 6 small cannon. It seems almost incredible that such a small craft should have been chosen to make a voyage that was to become of immense importance to Britain as a trading nation. On June the 3rd, 1668, the two vessels sailed out of the Thames bound for Hudson Bay. Nonsuch, under the command of Captain Zachariah Gillam, had Grésilliers aboard. The ships and their crews soon sailed on into the rigors and dangers of the Atlantic crossing. Here they were pounded by high seas, buffeted by gale force winds, until finally, badly damaged by the storms, the Eaglet gave up, turned about, and set course for home. Alone now, Nonsuch sailed on and finally made landfall on the southern end of James Bay on the 1st of October, 1668. Here the adventurers prepared to sit out the winter. Before the snows fell, the crew built a log hut surrounded by a stockade known as Charles Fort, and then waited for the spring. When the melting winter ice began crunching its way down Rupert River, it brought with it spring, Indians, and furs. Soon, every available foot of storage space upon Nonsuch was crammed with prime beaver skins. By August 1669, boat and crew were ready to leave for home. And sometime between September and October, the Nonsuch arrived in Plymouth. These 15 months of voyaging and adventure had not only vindicated the theatres of Grésilliers, but had founded the Hudson's Bay Company.
On May the 2nd, 1670, those men whose foresight and enterprise had made the voyage possible received their charter as the Governor and Company of Adventurers of England trading into Hudson's Bay. Their first governor was Prince Rupert.
All this took place 300 years ago. In order to mark the anniversary, the Hudson's Bay Company decided to build a new Nonsuch, as near as possible to an exact replica of that vessel on which the company was founded. And where better or more appropriate to build her than here, Appledore, on the bank of the River Torridge, on the mouth of the Tor Torridge estuary in North. No port in Britain has prouder connections or traditions with the sea than Appledore. Her seamen were crossing at the Atlantic in 1587, hoping to colonize North America. Her fishing fleet was fishing off the North American coast before 1700. Her trade with Newfoundland rivaled that of the Port of London, and her sailing vessels developed the timber trade between Canada and England, bringing the cargo back to Biddeford and Appledore. Last port in Britain still owning and running a commercial sailing fleet was Appledore.
The firm chosen to build the new Nonsuch was that of Alan Hinks. His family have a tradition of boat building stretching back for 150 years and including a second prize for a model of the best lifeboat in the 1851 exhibition.
It was started by my great-grandfather about 1844, and it's been passed down from father to son since then down to me. We build practically anything in conventional construction, including yachts and fishing craft, commercial craft and so on. I've never built anything like this before, but I've always been extremely interested in this sort of ship, and from the very first moment of seeing the drawings, I was very keen on being able to build it.
The real problems began, however, with the laying of the keel, a ceremony which took place in front of the governor of the Hudson's Bay Company, Lord Amery. With every day that passed, the realization that the builder and his staff had not just undertaken a normal job of work, but had accepted a challenge to reconstruct and build a vessel of a bygone age, became more and more apparent. Many of the skills required in the building of such a craft had passed out of use or had been forgotten. Of the workmen themselves, only a handful had been boy apprentices in the days of Appledore's wooden sailing ships.
They're all our own staff. We have probably taken out a couple of extra people since we started, but apart from riggers and caulkers, it's all our own people that's built the ship. The general run of the tools that they've used, they've been fairly conversant with, such as the adze and the augers and things like that. The biggest difference we had were making tree nails. We had to get a special tool to make these tree nails, and also get the knack of using them and fastening the planking.
Gradually, the skeleton of the Nonsuch began to take shape. The great frames reared up around the boat shed like the bones of some prehistoric monster awaiting its skin.
The skin, when it came, was fitted in the shape of 2-inch thick planks, molded and softened in jets of steam, the easier to shape them to the fullness of the curves of the bow and stern.
The whole of Britain was searched for suitable timber. All the wood is solid. No laminated timber is fitted anywhere on board.
I was very fortunate. I found this excellent oak for the planking at Andover. A lot of the big oak members I found a very good timber yard at Bury St. Edmunds. A lot of the framing actually used in the ship was already partially converted and would have gone into the Endeavour had she been built at Biddeford. The spars, that was pretty straightforward with the exception of the mammoth. The mammoth was a problem. This called for a specimen tree. It had to be homegrown timber, Scots pine, to meet the specification. And this did present some difficulty. I did an awful lot of running around trying to find this, and we had several trees felled, which proved to be no good. But in the end, we finally located an excellent piece at Longleat, and this has provided the mass that we got here now.
Within the boat shed became that of men reveling in the opportunity to apply their craftsman's ability to a job that would bear ample witness to their skills and labors.
I know that they're extremely proud of having the opportunity of building this ship, and this is really their baby, and they've taken an awful interest and put everything into it. I think we shall all miss her when she goes. Normally, ordinary boats should take an interest, but naturally you're always glad to see the job completed and away. But I think here in this case, I think we're all going to miss the Nonsuch when she goes. It's been sort of a way of life for 12 months for us all.
crafts involved in the building of the Nonsuch, that of the wood carver is probably the most exacting and rewarding. Jack Whitehead, wood sculptor, studio is on the Isle of Wight, is a name known wherever boat enthusiasts meet together. It was he who carved the figurehead for the Sir Winston Churchill and for her sister ship. Jack Whitehead's talents are widely appreciated and sought after, so it is no surprise to find that it was he who was responsible for all the carving aboard the Nonsuch.
I was carving a figurehead at the boat show 2 years ago, and I was approached by a representative of Mr. Warrington Smythe and asked if I was interested in doing the carving, so a replica they proposed to build of the Nonsuch. They had specified as far as possible the sort of timber that would have been used 300 years ago in the original Nonsuch, and we chose a mixture. Some of the carvings were in yellow pine and some were in English oak. We did a little research because one of the difficulties was the carvings had to be carried out in the same style and finish as they would have been originally. And of course no sandpaper was used anyway, carving tools haven't altered for generations, they're still the same shape. The drawings were only really rough sketches, and it was up to us to use a bit of imagination. And in fact, we gave all the carvings on the stern, these large females between the windows, a different expression and things like that. But it was a great challenge, because although we've done lots of carving for ships, we've never done anything had such a variety of carving and such a quantity of carving on it, and it took us about 8 months altogether. And it was a very interesting job, you know. We got so interested in this that somehow it ceased to be a job, but it was a most interesting, absorbing thing, and we had a little bit of a loss, now it's over.
The new Nonsuch was designed by Rodney Warrington Smythe. Research for the catch took him to the archives of the Hudson's Bay Company and the National Maritime Museum at Greenwich. Here he studied 17th century models of sailing vessels, looked at paintings, and read every manuscript describing boat building techniques of the period he could lay a hand to. He was also advised by the head of the Department of Ships at the museum, George Nash. His final working drawings are as near as any man can come to designing a 17th century catch in the present day.
Well, designing, I maintain, is really not quite the right term. The man who designed the Nonsuch lived 300 years ago. Our job was to try and reconstruct the vessel that he designed, and it is therefore not quite correct to say that we designed her. We had dimensions given, and from then on we had to do the best we could to reproduce the ship of the period. The National Maritime Museum provided a certain amount of information. Our difficulty was that this size of ship left no drawings. There were no records. The only thing we had to go by was Pepys's naval record in the Museum Baron Magdalen College, which gave the leading dimensions.
Length on the keel, 36 feet. Beam, 15 feet. Depth in the hold, 7 feet. Draft, 6 feet 6 inches. Tonnage, 43 tons. Normally carrying 6 guns and 12 men.
The key, of course, to the situation was that I knew the right people. I was able to assemble a small team of experts. Main person who led under me was Peter Wood, the marine artist. He's very interested in period ships. With him I had Percy Dalton, who's been my assistant for many years, but he's also very interested in period ships. So with these two we started off on our researches. That's how the job started.
Now, Nonsuch looks and feels like a ship ready and anxious to take to the water. Only one job is left to be done before she's launched, but that an essential and exciting one. Paint ship.
August the 26th, 1968, Mrs. Hesketh Amory mounted the rostrum erected in the boat shed in preparation for the launching. By her side stood the man whose decision had made the whole project possible, her nephew, the governor of the Hudson's Bay Company, Lord Amory. The time chosen was late evening, for only then would the tide make sufficient depth of water to float the vessel. With the growing dusk casting long shadows over the darkening sandbanks of the estuary, hundreds of well-wishers lined the banks of the tollage, ready to speed Nonsuch on her way as she would launch. Mrs. Avery will now name the ship.
I name this ship Nonsuch, and I wish her and all who stay near her Godspeed.
The champagne bottle burst against the bow, and the ship moved slowly down the ramp into the river. A cheer arose that touched the heart of every man who had been part of this unique and splendid achievement. Only one task remains unfinished before Nonsuch is ready for the sea. The fitting of the masts and their attached spars, stays and rigging. For this, the technical facilities of a large, flourishing boatyard at present building modern tugs and trawlers are borrowed and combined with the skills of the men of Alan Hinkshaw. The job is swiftly completed. November was a mild, clear, sun-bright day, perfect for sailing. Nonsuch left the shelter of the estuary, crossed the bar, and nosed into the Atlantic on her first voyage, bound for Falmouth. The coast of North Devon and Cornwall has for centuries earned respect among seafaring men as a graveyard for sailing vessels, and has been commemorated in verse. From Hartland Point to London Light is a watery grave by day and night. Rounding land there, Nonsuch was battered by gale-force winds, which drove her perilously near the rocks of the Lizard. But summing up the true spirit of her predecessor, she weathered the conditions and eventually tied up on her buoy in Falmouth, ready for the forthcoming weeks of intensive
sea child. No finer situation could have been chosen to prove the seagoing capabilities of Nonsuch than here at Falmouth. The seafaring traditions of this Cornish harbour are renowned and respected throughout the world. As Nonsuch, with fresh paint gleaming, dipped her bowsprit into the tidal flow of the Carrick Roads, she made an exciting and romantic picture, bringing back to the people of the town memories of the days of the many sailed clipper ships that once regarded Falmouth as home.
Get those sheets back if you can. Two more in the break.
Oh, well, lad.
Lay off, boy.
The master of Nonsuch is Adrian Small, a man with extensive seagoing experience under Canvas. In 1946, he went to sea on a Finnish grain ship on the Australian run as an apprentice. He worked in conditions of service that were almost reminiscent of the bad old days of sail, living on salt meat and rationed water, all for the princely sum of 10 shillings a month. Later, he became second mate aboard the Mayflower on her outward voyage to America. Then he has been the master of vessel due for filming in America, one of the films starring Julie Andrews. Here he met and sailed with two other members of the Nonsuch crew, mate Nigel Glassborough, who was mate under the command of the one-time master of the Mayflower, Alan Villiers, on another film epic, and finally, the bosun, Mark Miles, American from California, who's also a very talented marine artist. With the days passing into weeks, Nonsuch begins to take on the weathered, sea-stained look of a vessel built not as a showpiece, but as a craft capable of taking on the maximum that the element can provoke and holding her own. Under the command of Adrian Small, Nonsuch and her crew have become a unified whole, working together in a disciplined harmony, in eager anticipation of the exciting future that lies ahead. On the 2nd of May, 1970, the Hudson's Bay Company celebrate their tercentenary. And sometime during that year, it is planned to present Nonsuch in Winnipeg, in the hope that future generations of Canadians may know the kind of men and craft it was that opened up such an important chapter in Canadian history, gave birth to a company that has forged unbreakable chains of trade and friendship between Great Britain and Canada for 300 years. governor and company of adventurers of England, trading into Hudson's Bay.